from that, she got her postdoc in Texas MD Anderson Center, Cancer Center. And through that, she was able to get a fellowship doing cancer prevention. So she has a lot of applied work that she's done using her research to help improve people's lives. Her research specifically is interested in health behaviors and how we can encourage people to make better health choices, like smoking cessation and healthy exercise. So without further ado, I'm going to let her take the floor. And I just want to have everyone give her a round of applause and thank her for putting this together for us.
And therapy-focused PhD, so my expertise comes more from that side of things. So what I did is I kind of put together a talk that I think answers a lot of the questions that I get from students who are advising or stopping by my office hours that will hopefully give you a better idea of what applied psychology even means, and then things that you might be able to do in the field with a bachelor's degree or a graduate degree. So that's my hope. And what I want to talk about today, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about my background and training. So Stephanie gave a nice introduction. I'll kind of expand on that a little bit so you can see where I'm coming from. I'm going to try to define for you what applied even means when we talk about applied psychology and how big of a field that actually is. Then we're going to get some examples of doing applied work, especially related to therapy at a bachelor's level, master's level, doctorate level. When we get to that part of the talk, the doctorate level, I'll tell you a little bit about some of the research that I've done with tobacco smoking and smoking cessation, which I think is probably the purest form of applied research that I've done in my career, and that was at some of the places that I worked as a psychologist. And then, lastly, we'll just talk really briefly about how to get involved. So if you really are interested in learning more about the field, learning more about your own interests, and trying to figure out where you might fit in, we'll talk about some of the strategies for getting more involved in this field. And I think it probably makes sense to hold off until questions until the end, so we'll do it that way. So what is applied psychology? It's a really broad field. This is from the APA, so the APA has their own division of applied psychology, and they say it is a branch of the field that uses psychological research, theory, and methods to address real-world issues. That covers a lot of things. In fact, it probably covers a lot of the research that our faculty in psychology are doing right now. So you can imagine, when you think about this, the different ways that psychology interacts with other disciplines. There's industrial organizational psychology, which is all focused on like hiring and selecting individuals and training individuals to be better at their jobs. There are ways that social psychology informs therapy and health research. We can think about the interaction with psychology and business, so using psychology to understand consumer decisions and marketing. So there's a lot that falls under this umbrella of applied psychology. And just one of those things is the clinical world, okay? So it's just a small piece of applied psychology. That's where I'm coming from, so I'm a clinical psychology, that's my area, clinical psychology. And this is really, it's more specific. It involves applying like psychological theories and principles to improving client outcomes and patient outcomes, so improving client well-being. So it's more focused on that like therapy and behavior change and world side of the field. It's still pretty a broad definition, as you can see, and you can be involved in this field with a bachelor's degree, a master's degree, or PhD, and I'll show you examples of what each of these looks like. But to be clear, when I say clinical psychology, I also mean counseling psychology, and I'm really talking about therapy. Okay, so those terms really mean very similar things. So that's going to be the focus of the talk, and that's really closer to my background. All right. So my career path was very windy. There were lots of twists and turns along the way. As Stephanie told you, I have a bachelor's in finance, investments, and banking. So that's actually the title of my degree. And when I was typing that in, when I was preparing for this talk, I thought, wow, I am so far from that right now. But that's where I started. And just to tell you, just to sidetrack a little bit and tell you the story about how I ended up a finance major, I remember when I was starting college, this was a few weeks before classes started my freshman year in Madison, Wisconsin, where I went to school. And we showed up and we have advising. And there's this giant room of advisors sitting at tables and a long line of students coming out the door. And as soon as we got to the front of the line, we went and sat down to an advisor. And I had 10 minutes with my advisor. And I remember he asked me, "So what do you want to do?" And I said, "I don't know. I'm not sure. Like, I'm here to try to figure that out." And I remember he told me, I think his exact words were, "Well, if you're undecided, you might consider business. That's a good practical degree to go with." And I thought to myself, okay, I'm a practical person, I guess. Maybe business will be what I do. And I got a degree in business, and I stayed there for quite a lot. I mean, I obviously finished the degree, but I remember during that time, like, not really reflecting on if this was a good choice for me or not. It's like, I signed up for it, I got done with the degree, and I graduated, and I wasn't putting too much thought into if it was a good fit for me. It wasn't. So I worked in finance for a little bit, and I really didn't like it. I realized that it wasn't a great place for me to be, and I started to think, oh no, what have I done? How did I end up here? And at that time, I took some night classes in psychology while I was working in finance. I studied really hard for the GREs, and I was lucky enough to get into a couple of clinical psychology programs. So that's how I took that course. Then when I started in psychology, I thought, okay, I really want to work with people with severe mental illness. Because that's what I think of when I think of psychology. I really didn't have a great idea what the profession was, even when I got into grad school, to be perfectly honest. And I thought, well, this is what I want to do. And I worked in that setting, as a therapist in that setting, and I realized it wasn't a great fit. It wasn't what I had expected, and I didn't think there was as much opportunity for me to see growth in patients like I was hoping for. So I switched again. So I'm like moving all over within my grad program, and eventually, through the course of graduate school and then internship and then postdoc afterwards, I came to the field of behavioral medicine, which is similar to health psychology. And if you take in or are in my health psychology class, you probably have a better sense of what that is. It essentially, the whole idea of the field is that health and well-being are influenced by biological, social, cultural, medical, environmental factors. And if we really want to understand well-being of people, we have to look at all those things interact. And so it's really focused on like how to help people in behavior change. A lot of work in this field works with patients who might have like a chronic medical condition and like mental health disorder together, and trying to help them kind of cope and move through that. So that's really what the field is, and that's what I would describe myself today. I'm a health psychologist in the field of behavioral medicine. So understanding that and kind of getting a sense of my history, hopefully you have a better sense for where I'm coming from and that what I'm going to be focusing on in the presentation today. Okay, so I always get this question from students, and they ask, okay, so I like therapy, but I don't know if I want to go to graduate school. I'd like to be involved in helping people in some way. What does that actually look like? Can I do that with a bachelor's degree, or do I have to go on to be a therapist? So I'm going to answer that question. But first I'm gonna show you this, and this actually, the chair of our department shared this with us, and I thought it provided nice context for this part of my talk. So most people who earn a psychology degree, bachelor's degree, don't go on to graduate school. So this is a survey in 2017 of recent psychology graduates, where they found that over half of the people surveyed did not go on to a graduate degree, and only 14% went on to a graduate program in psychology in particular. So that gives a sense of where most psychology majors are going. So back to the question of, what if I want to do work that's kind of related to therapy, but I have my bachelor's degree, can I do that, and what kind of jobs are available for that? The answer is yes, you can. I pulled this from the American Psychological Association, so the APA, but they have a whole long list of things that you can do in these different fields. Psychology-related and non-psychology-related professions, and I just pulled a couple of them from that site to give you examples. But I would say probably one of the more common places that people end up working with a bachelor's degree in psychology, if they have interest in the therapy side, remember we're focused just on therapy now, is in a caseworker type of job. So in that type of job, you might work in child welfare, substance abuse, you might work in a group home, an inpatient psychiatric facility. And what you do there is you're doing a lot of intakes as people are coming into the clinic. You are running groups, like therapy groups for patients. You're checking in on their progress. You're doing progress reports, you're referring people out to services in the community and getting them connected with services that they might need. That's what a caseworker does. There's a lot of caseworker jobs out there. Most of them are looking for people with psychology degrees. You can do that work without a psychology degree sometimes, but then you usually need to get an additional certification. In addition to that, this is a really common profession as well. So ABA technicians are people with bachelor's degrees. Usually they're looking for people in psychology who provide behavioral support services for children and families. Oftentimes, you know, the children will have like a diagnosis of autism or other developmental disability, but they're frequently looking to hire people with bachelor's degrees, and it's very much closely related to therapy. So you're not technically doing therapy in these professions because you're not a licensed therapist, but the work is quite similar. You'd be supervised and the billing is different, but it's still quite on the non-psychology related side, there's a lot of things that you can do with a psychology degree that I'm sure you may have seen before that aren't specific to the field of psychology, but I think any of the skills that you're learning would obviously be great preparation for that. So some of these, but not all of these, require a bachelor's degree. Okay, so I just pulled this on Indeed.com. I always get this question too. Where can I apply locally now that I'm graduating? What I thought was interesting is the two common things that come up locally in Humboldt County for psychology, people with psychology degrees, are case manager positions and ABA technician positions. Those are commonly posted. There's a lot of them available right now. The one that I highlighted is a case manager position. The job duties and job descriptions are really similar to what I talked about, so doing intakes, providing support, referring out, and they're specifically looking for people with a background in psychology. So you'd be eligible for that job. These ABA positions oftentimes hire students before they even graduate. So if they're in school, you can still get some of these jobs. So it's a great place for employment in school as well. Okay, so here's an example. I'm pulling in examples throughout as I'm talking about these different tracks just to give you a sense of what this looks like or what our students are doing. Some of you may know Vicente. He shared this information with me and gave me permission to post this picture and this information. Vicente is a former student of mine who is working in a field like, he's like an ABA technician, but his job title is family specialist. He's working in Colton, California at a nonprofit organization. This is what he says he does. He does crisis intervention and family-based behavioral modification for children, adolescents, and adults age 5 to 21. He works primarily with people who have a diagnosis of PTSD, major depressive disorder, ODD, or schizophrenia. So it's really focused in that area. And he's doing this work with his bachelor's in psychology. Right? So that's what he's up to. Okay. So how about clinical careers with a master's degree? What does that look like? If you're working in psychology with a master's degree in the therapy field, remember, we're focusing on this in particular in my talk, but essentially what that means is that you're going to school to be a licensed therapist, which is different from the bachelor's level positions that I just talked about. That means you can call yourself a therapist, you can say I'm actually doing therapy, and you can bill insurance companies for the therapy that you're doing without having to like have someone else sign off on the work that you're doing. So that's what that means. And this is to remind you all and to me that we're only really talking about a couple of the different fields. In the applied world, there are so many other different graduate programs that are related to applied work, like school psychology, behavior analysis, for example. The ones that are underlined are the ones I'm going to talk about. So we're going to talk about the master's in counseling, we'll talk about Ph.D. in clinical and counseling, and Psych in clinical and counseling. But I want to remind you that the applied field is much broader, and even if you are interested in like therapy or the helping profession, there are other ways to get involved than just the ones that I'm talking about today. So very briefly, one slide on a marriage and family therapist. I coordinate the counseling psychology program here at HSU, so this one is near and dear to me. But a marriage and family therapist is a master's in counseling. This is it sets you up to be a licensed counselor, essentially. But it's very misleading. So if you hear the term marriage and family therapist, what do you think you're doing when you hear that? Marriage counseling, right? So not true. So it's actually a really broad-based general therapy degree. You can do marriage counseling if you want, but that is not the focus of the program. So this is more of a broad-based master's level therapist degree,
that trains you to be individual counselors, work with families, with children, with adults, with groups. You could work in any number of different settings, so you could work as in private practice, or in a hospital, or a mental health facility, or an inpatient clinic, in all sorts of different settings. So it's really misleading. We just do this in California. Most other states use what's called an LPCC, more commonly, a licensed professional clinical counselor. That makes more sense to me, that title. This one, I think, is a little misleading. So this is a very general counseling degree. How do you become licensed if you're interested in this route? You have to complete 60 units of graduate coursework. That's a lot, but a lot of programs fit that into 2 or 3 years. Then you have to also complete 150 hours of supervised face-to-face counseling while you're in the program. And then when you graduate, there is you have to complete 3,000 supervised hours before you can become licensed. So that can take a while. For some students, the fastest I've ever seen anyone do that was 2 years. I think 3 or 4 years is a little bit more common. But know that if you graduate from this program, there's more work to do after that. Usually these are paid positions, though. The internship years are often paid positions. Then once you complete your 3,000 supervised hours, you're eligible to apply for licensure and become a licensed therapist. So then you would be an LMFT, a licensed marriage and family therapist. So I just wanted to provide two examples of people working locally in our community who are former graduates of our program to give you a sense of what these positions look like. This is Liz Knight. She is a program manager of clinical services at Remy Vista in Eureka. She supervises some of us students in our program now. This is what she shared with me about everything that she does. She does a lot of supervision of therapists, including bachelor's level mental health workers. She does a lot of training. She develops policies and procedures in the clinic. She is responsible for accuracy of all insurance billing. But she says, the best part of my job is mentoring therapists and supporting their professional growth. So that's her favorite part. She also does that for our program. One more example before we move on for masters. This is Carlos Gonzalez Bobadilla. He is a mental health clinical coordinator at Making Headway Center for Brain Injury Recovery in Eureka. Some of you may have heard of Making Headway before. He has a more of a managerial position there. Students also work with him. I'm just going to read to you what he says he does. So my area of focus is trauma in all of its facets, emotional, psychological, physical, and the impact it has on mental health. I work with people who've been diagnosed with traumatic brain injury, people who have been charged with domestic violence or child abuse, and people who have experienced traumatic events. I practice CBT and EMDR, so those are different types of treatment modalities, as my main therapeutic modalities. I make sure the program is running as expected, as well as provide individual group counseling. I also provide counseling services in both English and Spanish. So another example of someone who's an LMFT and now kind of moving more towards a managerial role. All right. So, what about a doctorate degree? What does that look like? And here I'll give you a few examples of my research that I've done as well. So, first of all, how do doctorate programs differ from master's level programs? If you are interested in becoming a therapist, there's really not much of a difference between like a master's level and then a PhD program. Ultimately, you're going to be trained in how to do therapy and be an effective therapist in both programs. There's a slight difference in pay for people who go on to the doctorate level, but I've talked to some people locally who say, as a doctorate level therapist, I get paid more by insurance companies, but not that much more. So I've actually heard some people question, why I went through the extra training to do that when what I really wanted to do was be a therapist. So I would say there's not much of a difference if you're really interested in therapy between the master's level and PhD level. Here, what's the difference in these different fields? So my PhD is in clinical psychology. You can also get a PhD in counseling psychology. Historically, clinical psychology really developed from more of a medical framework, so there is a lot more focus on diagnosing and assessment. Then in counseling psychology, they emphasize that less. There's more of a focus on therapy and therapeutic change. However, they're quite similar. So that's really the only difference, and I would say if you either one of these, you're going to get similar training, you're probably going to be in similar settings working. So why might you get a PhD instead of a master's? I would say really if you're interested in research and you might want to work in an academic setting, this will prepare you
like you're not doing like a dissertation, a research dissertation in the counseling psychology program, for example. So if there's you really have strong research interest, you would be likely to get that here versus here. What's a PsyD? I get this question a lot as well. So PsyD is a doctorate level program that trains you to be a therapist that doesn't emphasize research. So that's the difference between PhD and PsyD programs in general. So if you are interested in like becoming a doctorate and you are not as interested in research, then a PsyD program might be a better fit for you. It's primarily focused on clinical training. PsyD programs admit a lot more students than PhD programs, but they're also a lot more expensive. So I've known students who've gone this route where they say, like, I've accumulated over 100 grand of debt after 4 to 5 years. So it can be very expensive. For some people, that makes sense, like financial sense, like I think I'm going to be earning enough to justify this, and for others, not so much. So that's just something to be aware of between these differences. And this is a chart that shows like where most doctorate level therapists are employed, and the takeaway point is most of them are employed in private practice, about half of them in hospital and university settings after. So private practice is pretty common for this order. Okay. So I'm going to talk a little bit here about my research really briefly. So PhD programs in clinical and counseling psychology emphasize research as part of the training. So you were doing a research-oriented dissertation. And a lot, so applied research then is usually research that takes place with real patients in clinical settings, in the world of therapy. That's usually how we think about applied research. You're like applying psychological theory and principles to better understanding clients and their experiences and improving like interventions to help with change. So this is really what applied research means. And now in the world of like clinical and counseling, that doesn't mean like if you go to a clinical program, you're only gonna be doing that type of research. But I kind of wanted to give you an example of what that looks like here, okay? So the clinical settings where I have worked and also done research, I worked in pain management, a cancer center at MD Anderson Cancer Center. I've worked in a smoking cessation clinic where I did some research, an HIV/AIDS treatment center. In these first two settings, I also did therapy. So I was working in those clinics doing therapy with patients who would come into the clinic, and then like my position was split between the clinical and research side. So I was kind of doing both things while I was there. So a little background about smoking. So I'm going to talk about one type of research that I did when I was working in those settings. The research that I do at HSU has kind of taken a little bit of a turn since coming here, but I think this is a nice example of what applied research can look like. So to give you a little bit more background about this area, smoking rates in this country, if you take my health psychology class, you know this, the prevalence of smoking in the United States right now is 14%. So that's down from like 44% in the 1960s. That was the peak in this country. We've just been chipping away at it, and the smoking prevalence has been going down, 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 down. However, in certain populations, like people with chronic pain conditions, the smoking rate is much higher. So here, some research suggests it's greater, like 30 to 50%, but we know that it's at least twice as much as what we find just the prevalence in the regular population. So why is this? One model that's typically used in this area of research to understand this is the reciprocal model of pain and smoking. So this is proposed by Joseph Dietrich. It really draws from reinforcement models of addiction. So basically what this says is when people experience pain, if you have a chronic pain condition and you experience like a spike in pain that's oftentimes associated with negative affect, like a sad mood and anxiety, which prompts urge to smoke. And the idea is when you experience urge to smoke and you smoke, that's the action of smoking actually reduces negative affect, so it's reducing people's feelings of depression and anxiety, and it's very reinforcing. So it increases a person's likelihood of continuing smoking down the road. Over time, that becomes a way of coping. So it's hard to break that association between the reduction in negative affect, so feeling better, and the cigarette. So that's how we think about this. Now it's called the reciprocal model, because essentially it says that pain motivates smoking in the short term. Smoking a cigarette can help reduce the negative affect associated with pain and make you feel better in the short term. But in the long term, it smoke tobacco. It's doing different things to our body. The components of tar and different chemical compounds likely lead to inflammation in our bodies, and that can lead to greater chronic pain conditions. But this is essentially what we're thinking about when we conceptualize how pain and smoking are related. So an example of some of the work that I've done. Remember I said that I worked in an HIV/AIDS treatment center. So a lot of the patients in that center were experiencing chronic pain. And there's also a really high rate of tobacco smoking among people living with HIV/AIDS. And one of the trials that they did in that center was looking at the effectiveness of a cell phone delivered intervention for smoking cessation in this group of patients. And one thing that we did, one of the analyses in that study, was to look at the association over time throughout the course of treatment using multi-level modeling between pain and smoking cessation outcomes. And to make a very long story short, essentially one of the things that we found was that higher experiences of pain throughout the treatment was associated with throughout the treatment was associated with greater likelihood of 24-hour and 7-day point of maintenance abstinence controlling for a bunch of different outcomes. So this is consistent with other research. So this was published when I was working in the cancer center with patients who had a chronic pain. These were patients who were coming in for smoking cessation treatment. And in this study, what we did was we had people come in, and there's a little app that they could fill out. It was an electronic daily diary app on their phones, and it would track their behavior throughout the day over a couple weeks. And in that app, they would report before smoking, during smoking, and after smoking, what's my mood, what's my experience of negative affect and sad mood, what's my urge to smoke, what are my expectancies related to smoking right now. They'd record that before smoking, during smoking, and after. And what we found in that study was that people who were reporting higher levels of pain were having lower success with treatment, but also that smoking did indeed reduce the reporting of pain pre to post smoking, which means that after people smoked, it was relieving, in a sense, pain or helping them to cope or manage with pain. That is consistent with the reciprocal model of pain and smoking that we talked about earlier. Okay, so who cares? Why does this matter? So one of the things in doing applied research is that you're really trying to understand, using psychological theories, the experience of your patients, because we want to essentially improve outcomes for our patients in these settings. So this research tells us a little bit more about what goes on with people, especially people with chronic pain when they're smoking. We know that it is triggering negative affect. We know that the experience of smoking is reducing negative affect and it is reducing pain. So that can be a very strong motivator. And that might explain why we are not seeing great success in helping people quit who are coming in with chronic pain and other chronic health conditions, okay? So what do we do with all of this? Well, in the field of behavioral medicine, there's a lot of different things that we can do for pain management that are evidence-based coping strategies to help people in coping with pain. There are ways that we can maybe integrate that more closely into smoking cessation treatment and maybe improve outcomes. There's a lot of ways that we can use this research to help try to improve outcomes for clients. Okay? So I wanted to give you this example just to show you what this looks like. This is just one example of applied research. This is very hands-on type research, but there's a lot of different ways that you can use theories and principles that you're learning in your classes to actually improve things. So, how to get involved. So if you're listening today and you're thinking, okay, so I am interested in this area, but I'd like to learn a little bit more about how to get involved in clinical or counseling psychology, or maybe just learn a little bit more about my own interests to see if this is something that I might like to do, most courses in the psychology major are going to give you a little more insight into this field, but I think specifically, if you're interested in therapy, courses like abnormal psychology or interviewing counseling techniques will allow you to kind of see what that looks like more in depth and practice some of these techniques in a more hands-on way that I think will give you more insight into, you know, do I like this or not? If you're interested in, we do have courses in ABA, if like the behavioral analysis therapy appeals to you, you could take those courses to see if you like it. If you're more interested in the health or medical side, there's a lot of neuropsych courses in our department as well that I think would be a good place to start. So talk with faculty and other multiple opinions. As much as you can, talk to professors or other people in the professions that you're interested in try to get a sense of what they like and dislike about it and how they got there. And then get experience. So either paid or volunteer experience. That's actually required for admission into the counseling psychology program. And I think it's also, in addition to helping you maybe get hired or get into graduate school, is a great way to learn more about, like, do I actually like this? So thank you, Jen Pachullo. She provided me with a full list of all of the places that she could think of that students in the past have either worked either for paid or volunteer experience. And most of these jobs will get you experience in the helping profession. Meaning when I say helping profession, I'm talking about therapy, essentially. And their examples might be like Planned Parenthood, Mad River Hospital, Humboldt Mediation Services. Some people have worked for crisis counseling lines. You might volunteer for hospice or volunteer at a homeless shelter. There's a lot of different ways to get involved. The Yes House on campus, so Youth Educational Services, also links students with volunteer experiences in the community. So if you're interested and want a little more help getting connected to those experiences, that place is a great place to start. Okay, so where's the field headed? There's a lot of job growth in the field of counseling and therapy, and most things that I've read have suggested over the next decade or so, we're going to continue to see a lot of growth in the field, so there will be demand for therapists. There's huge demand locally. So I don't know if you've noticed, but we have a really strong need for mental health services locally and not many therapists to fill those positions. So if you do end up going into this field, either at a bachelor's level or a master's level, and you stay locally, I think you'll find a lot of job opportunity. Another big trend that's shaping the field of clinical and counseling psychology moving forward is more integration into medical systems. So in the past, it was the case where we had psychology and we had medicine, and they were their own kind of pillars doing their own thing, not really communicating very much. But over the years, we've seen this kind of merging, where we have more integrated care. And that means that psychologists are being employed and mental health workers a lot more in medical settings, and we're thinking more holistically about health. So that, I think, will continue to open up job opportunities in this field. And we also have a really strong need for bilingual therapists as well. If you look at a lot of job postings, they'll often say, like, a bilingual therapist is preferred and sometimes required. So if you have those skills, that is a strong need in the field, and that's definitely the direction the field is moving. Okay, so if you have more questions, this is my office. I don't have my office hours up yet for next semester, but I do encourage you to stop by if you have questions for me. I'm always happy to talk about careers and things that and ways to get involved in the field if you have questions. So please feel free to stop by. But how about questions for me? Yes.
Can you explain one more time quickly what the difference between a PhD in clinical and counseling psychology are?
Yeah, so the question is, what's the difference between a PhD in clinical and counseling psychology? My short answer is not much, but technically clinical psychology focuses more on diagnosis and assessment, and is people in clinical psychology are more often to be employed in, like, medical. I would say, but the difference is so small. They're very similar. Yes. Yes.
Is there like a pay grade difference between like a PsyD and a PhD in, let's say, like clinical psychology?
So the question is there a pay difference between PhD and PsyDs? No. It's just a doctoral level like reimbursement from insurance companies.
Okay.
So it's the same.
Is there, or do you know why most people with doctorate degrees work at private practice instead of a university or hospital? Are there better incentives, or is it just there's more need for?
That's a great question. So why are more people employed in private practice? I think it's just a preference for individuals to kind of be their own boss and be independently employed. I really think that's just what it is. There's a lot of jobs available elsewhere. But I think people like are attracted to that lifestyle. Yeah. That would be my sense. can talk a little bit more about that. Is there a specific question that you have?
No, I just want to know more about it.
Okay. So the counseling program at HSU is a 2-year program. If you're interested in that program, we have brochures in the office, so you could feel free to stop by and take a look. Experiences at CAPS, so you get some clinical training there, and then there are opportunities to go out into the community and get training there as well at different placements that we have. So some of the people that you saw today in the presentation actually train and supervise our students at the office. Yes, Maria?
Can you talk about the different application process for a PhD versus an MA and what the expectations are in those applications?
So can you repeat that?
So the application process, what is the expectation in the PhD application versus an MA application?
Yeah, so what are the differences in expectations for master's versus PhD? So in PhD programs, I think there's just much more focus on research experience. I'll look for that more in your applications, and they will in the master's programs where that's not as probably heavily focused, at least in the clinical world. So if you're really wanting to prepare for a PhD program, getting good experience in labs, is a good place to start. And if you can, maybe be involved in like a presentation at a conference or developing a presentation or paper in some way. I think that would also really help. So that's the short answer.
Yes. So I'm hoping for
Agner
to research.
Okay, so the question is, like, if you're applying to a PhD program, do you need to identify an advisor to be working with ahead of time? Is it the same for non-clinical? Yes, it's the same. So the application process is very similar, where you would identify a research mentor who has similar research interests to you and say in your application, I would want to work with this person and do these things. Yeah, that's exactly what it's like. Yes. Yeah.
So you mentioned the PhD is more like research inclined. So for the MFT master's program, is that also more research inclined, or is it like primarily for a license in counseling?
So the MFT master's program, definitely you need strong research skills to do well in the program and to prepare you to be an effective therapist, but you don't have to do like a research project like you would in a PhD program. So there is a difference. You need the skills, but you don't need your research master's. You definitely emphasize research skills and developing those.
Can you go over some of the facets of like career pathways with the MFT master's program? Like, if you're going over in your talk, you were saying about being a counselor, what are the potential like other career paths?
With the master's degree, is that what you're saying? So, like, back up to the slide.
Like, specifically to the MFT program.
Oh, other career pathways. So really the MFT program sets you up to be a licensed therapist, but you could like not become a licensed therapist and use the degree to maybe do more like program evaluation or things like that in the agencies locally. So some people don't do as much therapy, they do more management, I guess, with the MFT. So that would be a different way to think about it. But most people, I'd say, they want to be a therapist. Mm-hmm. Therapy is a big part of their life. Yeah. Yes.
What would you recommend if you are trying to look for like mentors and how to get involved with, you know, getting into that part of your application and like, you know, trying to figure out that kind of stuff?
For applying like for?
For just like a graduate program, if you need a mentor to like oversee your research or like not necessarily oversee research but just like, an advisor, I guess.
Oh, okay. So if you're looking to identify that in an application, I would start by looking at the website and maybe contacting some people who are on there to see if they're taking students and kind of seeing if that would be a good fit to make sure that they're even open and available for students before identifying that in an application. Yeah. Yeah. All right. Any other questions? No. I will stay here after if anyone has further questions. But thank you.